Hi, welcome to the Virtual Propane Expo. This is Bill Stomp. Today we have Gokul Viswanathan with us from PERC. And PERC has hired him to be like a resident expert in technology. So some of his role, he has a lot of experience in technology as an engineer, as a PhD, and having worked with the likes of the Advanced Research Projects Agency, the energy side of that, for the Department of Energy. So a lot of cool experience from a lot of different areas that he brings to us as an industry to help us as we continue to progress and learn for ways to increase propane's usage and consult with us on how to do that, having worked for Booz Allen Hamilton, which is one of the leading agent consulting firms in the world. He's in some ways, in my opinion, he is almost like a consultant for the propane industry on how to grow propane gallons and how to make our industry succeed. So really glad to have Gokul here with us. The title of his presentation is Leaping Forward in a Post-COVID World, and so we're super excited about having him here. And he's an advocate for propane. He's an advocate for our businesses. He's an advocate for growth, which means an advocate for helping us make more money. So that's awesome, right? So hey, thanks again for being here, Gokul, and I'll be handing off to you and let you share your screen. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Bill. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and pleasure to present to the propane community about my thoughts on, how we move forward from this disruptive COVID-19 pandemic that has occurred this year, which has actually disrupted all of our lives in some form or fashion, directly or indirectly. So again, thank you for having me. Like Bill said, I am Gokul Viswanathan. I serve as the Director of Research and Sustainability at the Propane Education and Research Council. Again, thank you for having me. Like you all know, Propane Education and Research Council is a nonprofit organization by the U.S. Congress, authorized by the U.S. Congress in 1996. And we do, benefit a variety of markets, including transportation, agriculture, commercial, landscaping, residential, and commercial building, and several others. A little bit about my background. Like I said, I am tasked with leading the initiatives to grow propane demand through research, technology, and sustainability programs within PERC. I've been at PERC for about five months now. And before joining PERC, I was actually working as a senior lead engineer at Booz Allen Hamilton. And I was a technical advisor at the U.S. Department of Energy, chiefly at the Advanced Research Projects Agency, Energy, ARPA-E, and also served a little bit at the more applied energy efficiency and renewable energy office, advanced manufacturing office, predominantly doing, technology consulting and technology advising analysis for combined heat and power, internal combustion engines, hybrid electric vehicles, thermal energy storage systems, carbon capture technologies, and also connected and automated vehicles. And before, being in the DOE circles, I spent about 3.5 years at Cummins, as a technical specialist and senior systems integration engineer, driving much of the diesel engine development and after-treatment development work. I have a PhD from University of Wisconsin, Madison, and a master's from University of Alabama, and got my Bachelor of Engineering in India, all mechanical engineering. So I'm a mechanical engineer by training and by practice. So, just introducing this. So I had accumulated a lot of thoughts, technical thoughts, during this COVID, especially during the early stages of COVID in the February, March timeframe of this year. And I thought to pen down all my thoughts into a white paper. And basically, this presentation is going to summarize some of the high-level items from that white paper. At the end of this presentation, I do give a link for the white paper. It has been published on LinkedIn. So, feel free to download the white paper, go through it. I'm more than happy to receive your input and thoughts and comments on it. There might be some things that you might not agree. There might be some things that you might agree with me. So it's always good to get both sides of the story. And I'll be more than happy to get the propane community's feedback on this white paper. So having said that, so basically, if you look at what COVID has done in terms of at least the early part of it, the February, March, April timeframe, right, it pretty much disrupted our travel, right? Specifically the aviation industry, right? So if you look at the aviation jet fuel demand during the early part of COVID, it actually tanked about 62%, and gasoline demand went down by 40% because most of us were not driving during that period of time to work, and still are not driving to work, right? So if you look at the traffic volumes in mid-March, if you see for the nationwide average, it went from 18 to 30% reduction in traffic volume. Seattle and San Francisco, which were the earlier hotspots for COVID-19, the epicenters of COVID-19, they saw about 30 to about 50% disruption in traffic volume. And Seattle and New York also saw about 40% disruption in traffic volumes. So this led to a gasoline demand reduction of about 40%, right? That was pretty challenging for the light duty vehicle industry and also for the aviation industry. If you look at the diesel demand, the diesel has a slightly different story. This is essentially showing the truck activity index for the state of California, specifically for the state of California. I picked California because California was one of the earlier hotspots or the epicenters of COVID-19. And during the same time frame, mid-March, if you see the trucking index actually just reduced to 98% or even 96%, that's pretty much it. The main reason was heavy-duty trucking was operating, right? I mean, we had our supply chain, which was completely intact at that period of time. Grocery stores were still stacked up with all essential commodities to some extent, except a few items such as kitchen towels and toilet paper and things like that. But most of our grocery items were still stacked up during this period of time. And these truck drivers were kind of the logistics folks were just getting their job done even during the heart of COVID-19. And hence, we don't see much reduction in diesel demand. Diesel demand just reduced by 20% and not much more. But having said that, if you look at propane, and I just plotted this chart for the first half of the year. So week one until week 26-ish. So if you look at this data is from the Department of Energy, Energy Information Administration. And I've plotted the propane and propylene sales product supplied for the years 2018, 2019, and 2020. So the 2020 is this orange curve over here. And the 2019 is the blue curve. And the 2018 is actually the gray curve. And if you see the difference between the propane sales during that period of time or the propane supply during that period of time, it's essentially not clearly distinguishable between the 3 years. And so propane was pretty resilient during this period of COVID-19, chiefly for the reason that everybody was hunkered down within the home. And it kind of COVID-19 collided along with the early spring season where still heating and hot water needs were like pretty high in many locations. So propane demand in the residential sector went up. Cooking, for example, right? I mean, that also went up. Propane from the commercial side of things might have gone down a little bit, but the residential demand actually went up. And this is not just true for the United States. This was actually a common occurrence all around the world. Actually, even in India, where LPG is used for cooking predominantly, you saw that there was a spike in propane or a spike in LPG during the pandemic. So, it was a pretty resilient fuel. Again, like the heavy duty industry was still working. So the propane bobtails were out there delivering the fuel when needed. And that's pretty good story for the industry as compared to, let's say, the jet fuel, the gasoline and the diesel fuel during the early part of the COVID. Shifting gears, I mean, COVID-19, because of all the disruption in aviation travel, light duty, cars and all that, which were not being, the traffic volumes went down and some to some extent heavy duty transportation was reduced, but not to a great extent. We did see a lot of difference in emissions, and air quality. One of the chief things that was plotted out was, the reduction in nitrogen oxide emissions, the reduction in particulate matter emissions. But there were very little studies that also showed what impact it had on the ozone pollution. And, if you look at this map around the U.S., this was published by NPR. It was pretty interesting. If you look at the map around the U.S., ozone did not decrease significantly, right? And, as much as 22% was the maximum reduction in ozone. And there are like 3 points shown over here. One is the Los Angeles area, one is the Houston area, and one is the Pittsburgh area. The LA saw about a 14% less ozone. That's it. The reason being that, LA has nearly the ports are nearly 30% of the shipping container traffic there. And so there was a lot of truck activity going on still in this area. The diesel trucks were still operating in that area and it didn't see much reduction in ozone. Houston, on the other hand, the petrochemical industry was still functioning at that period of time, even though, commercial and light commercial and residential folks were hunkered down and all that and commercial entities were closed. The petrochemical industry was chiefly operating at that time. And so Houston only saw about a 12% reduction in ozone. While Pittsburgh area showed about 9% less ozone because of coal power plants being operated during that period of time. So ozone, did not see a major reduction. And again, this was not just a U.S. phenomenon. This was actually also seen in some parts of China, also in other parts in Asia as well. And I feel this is where our industry can contribute, right? I mean, propane being this fuel that leads to, when it's combusted, leads to very low nitrogen oxide emissions, which is one of the precursors for ozone pollution, right? And so, it's a very clean fuel to use. There are multiple uses for it, especially in the medium duty and heavy duty sector, right? I mean, You can displace many of these diesels that are causing this pollution with propane. And I see that there is a disruption that can be done in that area with propane. You know, there is a white space that can be leveraged for propane. If you, speaking about diesel engines a little bit more, right? You know, if you see the transportation diesel engines and what California is going towards, you know, emission standards, which are called as low NOx and ultra low NOx emission standards. The low NOx emission standards will be in place from 2024, and the ultra low NOx emission standards will be in place from 2027. So if you look at, you know, and these are pretty challenging. For example, the ultra low NOx is targeting about 0.02 grams per horsepower hour of emissions from the engine or from the tailpipe of these heavy duty vehicles, right? And so this study was done at the Southwest Research Institute to meet these emissions. And if you look at the exhaust after treatment or the catalyst complications, I mean, they show two sample catalyst architectures here, where you have a light-off selective catalytic reduction catalyst, which reduces nitrogen oxide emissions, a diesel oxidation catalyst, which always is put on a diesel engine, a particulate filter, which is also put on a diesel engine for reducing particulate matter emissions. Then you have the typical urea selective catalytic reduction catalyst, which is also in place right now in several diesel engines. And then since you inject urea or the diesel exhaust fluid, you produce ammonia as a byproduct, right? And that ammonia is essentially after the reaction, you have to, it slips out of the tailpipe, and you have to reduce that slip. And so you have an ammonia slip catalyst at the end of it, right? So you have to reduce the ammonia emissions as well in diesel trucks. So, and that's one architecture. The second architecture is you have a passive NOx absorber instead of this light off selective catalytic reduction. So these two are NOx catalysts. Reducing NOx is the challenge here, right? And then you have this typical, diesel oxidation catalyst, a filter, you know, then the whole nine yards of having the selective catalytic reduction catalyst and the ammonia. So what I'm trying to say here is after treatment or diesel catalysts are getting complex by the day. Costs are going to increase because these are all loaded with platinum metals, right? And so, you know, it's there is a price tag for these engines as we go forward in the future, right? While on the other hand, other end of the spectrum, you have the spark ignited propane engine, right? And that can just operate with a three-way catalyst. And there are several companies that are already meeting the low NOx emissions targets with within the propane industry. And, you know, with a little bit more work on the catalyst, we can even meet the ultra low NOx emissions technologies. And the added plus is you don't need this particulate filter for a propane engine because propane produces near zero particulate matter, right? So a propane engine is actually a much, much simpler, which means it's a cost-effective engine as compared to a diesel engine as we go forward for the medium duty and heavy duty sector. And I see this as a ripe area for disruption for our industry as we move forward. And PERC is actually working with our partners for developing, high efficiency, low emissions, several propane engines. It's just shifting gears here in terms of power generation. You know, I saw that this plot was a little bit, you know, very intuitive that was published by Unison Energy. And they kind of give us a roadmap in terms of how you want to go into carbon neutrality. And this example is given for a typical California industrial facility. And so they have a five-step process. The first step is essentially they recommend to invest in high efficiency solutions, meaning let's say upgrading boilers, upgrading chillers, LED lights, and so on and so forth. So if you want to go for a high efficiency propane boiler, you know, that by itself will lead to about 5-15% efficiency improvements, right? The second important thing is using renewables where possible, right? So if it's an industrial facility, if you are able to use solar panels, solar PV, and then that could also lead to, you know, reduce carbon footprint, they expect about an 8-20% reduction in carbon footprint. The third part of the equation is using combined heat and power or cogeneration, right? So basically, instead of buying electricity from the grid, the lion's share of electricity from the grid, you can have an engine or a turbine or something like that. You just put propane as a fuel to it. It produces electricity. You can use it for your industrial facility. The waste heat that comes out of that, be it the exhaust heat or the coolant rejected heat, that could be used for, that heat can be captured. And it could be used for your local hot water demands, sometimes even space heating demands, process heating demands in industrial facilities and so on and so forth. So it's very efficient, right? It's very efficient. The transmission and distribution losses of electricity from the grid are also cut down. So it's a very efficient solution. So CHP is a key solution, at least in my perspective, about 20-25% efficiency benefit from CHP. Of course, this is going to come in the future, decarbonization of fuels. And I have a slide talking about that, using more biofuels, renewable fuels, synthetic fuels, so on and so forth. And that has that actually reduces the carbon footprint significantly, right? And then finally use carbon offsets. But if that's not available, then if zero carbon fuels are not available, use carbon offsets, like reforestation. You know, I mean, trees are one of our best friends in reducing the carbon from the environment, carbon dioxide from the environment. So this kind of gives kind of a roadmap. It's very broad, but it kind of gives a very nice roadmap that, you know, you don't have to have all electrification and all 100% renewable penetration, which is kind of the utopia that people are expecting in the future. But there are several other technologies using conventional fuels, using renewable fuels, using synthetic fuels, and that can all lead to a low carbon future as we move forward in this journey. Specifically, I have a background in internal combustion engines. I want to take one slide at least to talk about internal combustion engines from the white paper. Essentially, there will always be a need for internal combustion engines. I mean, the spiraling death of internal combustion engines has been, you know, kind of addressed in many places where they're saying that internal combustion engines is not going to exist beyond 2030. 2035. Some places are even banned, such as UK, are even banning internal combustion engines, diesel engines in several locations, and so on and so forth. And even internal combustion engines from many places, right? And so from a power generation standpoint, right, Wärtsilä has done some really good work. And so they have this kind of this idea about if you are looking for a power generation mix from scratch, and if you want to do it 100% renewable, right, quote unquote 100% renewable, how do you do that? And so Mid-Atlantic, I live in the state of Maryland, so I was just curious about Mid-Atlantic, but I've also done an analysis for the other states or other regions within the US. For Mid-Atlantic, right, what they propose is in the future, you would need, if you want a 100% renewable future, you would need about 60% solar, about 35% wind, a few percent of hydropower, and 25% of energy storage, be it batteries, be it even fuels, synthetic fuels, right? I mean, if you have excess electricity being generated by solar and wind and hydro, then you can use that electricity. You can capture carbon dioxide from processes, and then you can use that captured carbon dioxide and this excess electricity and generate synthetic fuels. So this includes batteries as well as synthetic fuels, right? Fuel is a type of an energy storage at the end of the day, right? But then you see this 5% of flexible gas, which is essentially flexible internal combustion engines operated with gas, right? And, you know, they say 5%, again, I think this is too aggressive. But again, even in this scenario, right, these resources that we are seeing, right, they will play a critical role in enabling that flexibility. Let's say the sun doesn't shine for a period of time, the wind doesn't blow for a period of time, then you need that flexible generation, you need that capacity to be delivered, you need fuels at the end of the day, right? And so these synthetic fuels, when there is excess of electricity, store it in the form of synthetic fuels, use it when you don't have renewable energy, use it to fuel these engines to produce electricity. And that's a very key solution or mix in enabling a 100% renewable future. Today, these flexible gas assets can be, you know, powered by conventional fuels, say conventional propane. But in the future, when we are looking at a zero carbon kind of an economy, you would need drop in renewable and synthetic fuels to power those flexible assets. The good thing about renewable fuels is they are extremely similar to conventional fuels. So you don't have to change this architecture of the engine. All you have to do is change the fuel and it should be running fine without any issues. So again, I want to emphasize the point that microgrids and combined heat and power systems will play a critical role along with centralized power plant generation in the future, because you need that kind of a flexibility at the end of the day. So we spoke a little bit about renewable fuels. We spoke a little bit about synthetic fuels. We spoke all those things. What is the outlook for propane, right? And so I just wanted to devote one slide for renewable propane, right? So renewable propane is a byproduct of renewable diesel and or sustainable aviation fuel that is used for the aircraft industry. About 5% of the feedstock can be captured as renewable propane. So there are several processes. I'm not going to go through each one of these processes, but I just wanted to highlight that there are several processes of making renewable propane. The most common commercialized process for making renewable diesel, renewable propane, which is HVO or hydrotreated vegetable oil. Right, so you use vegetable oil, animal fat, beef tallow, whatever, you know, and you hydrotreat them, you know, knock off the oxygen as much as you can, and you produce hydrocarbons. And then you produce biodiesel, renewable diesel, or aviation fuel, or whatnot. But then biopropane comes as a byproduct, which is about 5 to 8% of the feedstock. So it's not a lot. We need to champion more efforts in this direction because right now we have approximately a capacity of about 5 to 10 million gallons in the US, and we with an M, and we spend about 10 billion gallons in the US of propane, which with a B, right? So there are orders of magnitude apart right now. And PERC is actually championing a lot of effort, you know, having a lot of conversations with many of these facilities that are, you know, kind of producing renewable diesel. We want to include renewable propane into the mix as well. And then finally, right, I want to take a moment and talk about renewable dimethyl ether or DME, which is very similar to propane. It can be transported very similar to propane, right, in a bobtail and all that. But it's a high cetane number fuel, which is basically what it means is it's actually a diesel fuel replacement in the future. It has very similar properties of combustion like propane, very low nitrogen oxide emissions, very, very low particulate matter emissions or near zero particulate matter emissions. So, you know, it's a great fuel for the future as well, along with propane. And so, you know, I feel that carbon neutrality can be enabled by these low carbon intensity fuels. And I'm not saying these are the only two fuels that can enable carbon neutrality. There are several other fuels, but I think we will be a part of the mix. We need to be a part of the mix as we move forward for a completely renewable future. Finally, some closing points. I just like to close this, right, with some set of perceptible or tangible conclusions that I made from this white paper. Some of these might not be related to this presentation because it's an exhaustive white paper and I tried to take some elements of it to kind of draft these closing points. But at the end of the day, if I were to deliver one message from this white paper, I just want to say that there is no silver bullet. There is no silver bullet for enabling a sustainable low emissions future, right? There has to be a mix of items that needs to be there. There will be a little bit of electrification. There will be hybrid electric vehicles. There will be internal combustion engines. Internal combustion engines are already there in hybrid electric vehicles. There will be turbines. There will be micro turbines and so on and so forth. There will be fuel cells. And then in terms of fuels, you know, you have electricity as one of the fuels. That is what, you know, folks are advocating very vehemently in many areas. But again, you cannot do away with conventional fuels and also renewable and synthetic fuels. So at the end of the day, there is no single solution. There is no silver bullet. You know, all these technologies have to be improved at the same time for us to enable a sustainable future. Like I said, again, internal combustion engines, I don't see an end to internal combustion engines. I think that 2050, 2055, 2060, I think they will still survive, be it power generation, be it as a hybrid electric vehicle, you know, be it transportation or whatever, they will still be there. Combustion turbines have a critical role to play as well, right? I mean, as you increase the size, they are more efficient than reciprocating internal combustion engines. And so they will have a part to play. You know, one thing that I did not highlight in this presentation, but I have highlighted in the white paper is that, you know, we generally very loosely use the term, when I say we, not just we, not us, but generally the community uses the term zero, quote unquote, zero emission vehicles. There is nothing called as zero emission vehicles. All vehicles emit emissions, even an electric vehicle emit emissions, not only during the production of the battery and the electricity that you get from the grid, but electric vehicles also have particulate matter emissions. You may ask how. They don't have tailpipe, so they probably don't have particulate matter emissions. But there are particulate matter emissions coming from the tires. There are particulate matter emissions coming from brake wear. And there are particulate matter emissions coming from resuspension, which is essentially these vehicles are heavier. And so some of these particulates that are on the ground are actually kind of they come back in an aerosol form into the air. So if someone says that electric vehicles don't have emissions, I mean, I just don't believe that, because electric vehicles have emissions in the production phase and also in the use phase. So the term zero emission vehicles is a misnomer, at least in my opinion. And you know, as we rebound from this disastrous economic consequences of COVID-19, we haven't done a complete rebound, right? And it's going to take years sometimes, according to some predictions. You know, we have to be cognizant of one fact, that yes, sustainability is important, absolutely important. But at the same time, we also have to devise a metric which is essentially cost per percent of CO2 reduction or something along that lines, so that we can have all the technologies in the spectrum. We can assess all the technologies and choose the most cost effective solution for enabling a sustainable future. And this is where I think propane will play a great part. You know, a lot of people said that, oh, the COVID-19 has disrupted, the air quality is awesome and things could look great for the future. But if you look at this figure that during the COVID-19, if you look at the losses, the economic losses and everything, this was close to $3,000 to $5,000 per percent of CO2 reduction or per ton of CO2 reduction. And so that's a pretty, pretty huge number. That is because we had a lot of economic losses because of COVID-19, because of the way it disrupted it. That's an egregious number, and that is an unacceptable number, right? So you need to have cost metric for all of these technologies that are under play. Like I said, you know, I mean, I cannot stress more, but renewable fuels are important. They need to be ramped up in terms of their production. There needs to be government incentives, public-private partnerships. Lots of these pilot-scale facilities need to be upscaled and so on and so forth. And so that is going to be a critical piece for our sustainable future. And finally, right, I'm preaching to the choir here, but you know, LPG has great properties, right? I mean, it can be easily liquefied at atmospheric temperature conditions. It can be, there are no aromatics in the fuel, which doesn't lead it to particulate matter formation. Low carbon to hydrogen ratio, so it has, you know, lower emissions, carbon dioxide emissions as compared to diesel, let's say, right? And so it will play a critical role for enabling a low carbon future. So again, thank you very much. I just want to close this. Thank you very much for, you know, for your attention. And this white paper, like I said, has been published on LinkedIn. The link is given here, you know, and if you have any thoughts, feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn, or my email address is there on propane.com PERC website. Feel free to shoot me an email regarding your thoughts, your comments, your input, and so on and so forth. And I'll be willing to have a discussion beyond this forum. So, Bill, thanks a lot for the opportunity. It was a pleasure to be here.
Gokul, thanks so much. Thank you very much. And for everyone that's in the expo, just want to, again, thank you for being here. And the whole expo is brought to you by the Virtual Propane Expo, as you can see here, and also by our sponsor, which is the award-winning propane safety app, also known as Tank Spotter. So for anyone out there that is looking for ways to reduce your costs, increase your profits, go paperless, do all your training remotely so your guys can be trained on the spot or review what they're looking at on the spot. They need to do their gas checks, leak checks, cathodic protections, hose inspections, vehicle inspections, truck inspections. If you want to dispatch your work to them remotely, instantly, and really essentially file all your paperwork instantly. TankSpotter is a partner with Amazon and works on the Amazon Web Servers and works on both Apple and Android. It's the only app for propane safety, sales, and service. The only app and delivery and training, the only app in the world that does all those things and does it on Apple and Android. So you don't need to buy any extra devices. So please check them out. It's at tankspotter.com, and they bring these great presenters to you. So thanks everyone for being here. And thanks for letting us show you a little bit of technology and showing you, you know, where we're heading as an industry. So Gokul, again, thanks for leading the insights there. And it's really great. So fantastic job. Thanks a lot. Thanks everybody.